I've made something really cool. It's a complete ESP32 ZX Spectrum emulator. Now, in the next version, the display will be integrated with the PCB. I did place an FPC connector on the board, but it's only compatible with the tiny displays I was using for the TV project. I have got some bigger displays on order, but displays are really a pain in the backside. So I'm going to use the bigger screen connected via jumper wires for this video. As you can see, we can play games. Manic Miner certainly brings back some memories, and it seems that I still have quite a lot of muscle memory from all those years ago. And we can even program in BASIC. I'm sure a few of you remember going into computer shops and getting the machines to print their names or possibly something more rude on the screen. It's really nice, and I know people are going to want one of these. It's not quite ready for production yet, this is very much at the proof of concept stage of things, but I have set up a mailing list for you to register your interest. If there's enough people wanting one, I'll set up a production run and put it on sale. There are a few things that need to be worked out, so despite this saying V1.0, it is very much more like V0.0. In good old Sir Clive Sinclair fashion, I'm going to aim for a pretty reasonable price point.
I want a computer that we can sell for the magic sum of £99.
The nice thing about this design is that the keyboard is all part of the PCB, so in theory, it should be pretty simple to manufacture. Now, why did I even build this? Well, I got a Spectrum emulator working on my ESP32 TV board a while back, and I was just going to do a video on that. But then I heard about the new full-colour silkscreen printing that's available from PCBWay, and I just had to try it. A Spectrum keyboard to go with the emulator seemed like a nice colourful thing to try and do. And it has come out amazingly well. The boys and girls at PCBWay have really done an incredible job. It's easy to underestimate just how cool this is. This is not just a simple printing job. The inks used need to be stable and keep their colour at high temperatures used in the reflow ovens and all the follow-up processing stages. It's pretty impressive that it works at all. So what's on the actual PCB? The brains of the operation are the good old ESP32-S3. This really simplifies things as it can be directly connected to the USB. We don't need any extra ICs. What's really cool with this design is that we're able to get all 40 keys feeding into just one ESP32-S3. I've done this by multiplexing the keys in a similar way to how the original Spectrum keyboard worked. This is possible because the S3 has 14 touch pins. For the 40 keys on this keyboard, we need 13 of those pins. There are 8 rows, each with 5 columns. We can detect each individual key by checking which column and which row is being touched simultaneously. It does work really well, and it's really responsive. I would say that it's just as good as the old dead flesh and mainframe keyboards on the old Spectrum. And it's much less likely to wear out. There is, however, a small trade-off that I'm going to fix in the next version of the board. I'll come back to that later. All the games are stored on an SD card. I've got over 1200 games on this card, and they take up around 65 megabytes. It's really easy to forget just how small 48K is. There's a small speaker. I've gone very classic for the sound output. It's a simple speaker driven by a transistor. One bit sound, just as Sir Clive originally intended. The results are surprisingly good. It is incredible what can be done with one bit sound. There is a great video I found recently that does a deep dive on this, definitely worth a watch. I've also added an earphone jack so you can plug an external speaker in. It sounds pretty good. There's a battery charger on board, so you could have your very own portable ZX Spectrum, perfect for working in your local coffee shop. though I do wonder if we're going to need a mute button. Displays are something that I'll sort out in the next prototype. There is an FPC connector for the tiny display that I'm using for the ESP32 TV project, but as you saw, this is way too small for real use. I've got a bunch of 3.2-inch displays on order from AliExpress that I'll try out in the next version. One frustrating thing with displays is that although most of them can be driven over standard 4-wire SPI, the pinouts on the FPC ribbon cables are all completely random. I've got some coming with 10 pins, 18 pins, and even 40 pins. It's completely bonkers. For a production run, I'll need to select a supplier and commit to whatever pinout they use. I will still break out the display via a header though, so we can plug in other displays if needed. As mentioned earlier, there are some trade-offs with the keyboard. You may have noticed when I was typing in the basic program earlier that for symbol shift, I tapped the symbol she key first and then the character that I wanted. I'm using a touch matrix for my keyboard, and with the approach I currently have, this means that only certain combinations of keys can work. In the original Spectrum keyboard, they prevented this by using some diodes on the address lines. Now, this is not really possible with a touch matrix, but I do have some ideas on how to fix this that I'll be trying out in the next revision. To be honest, it's not a big limitation, but it does mean that some games can have some surprising behaviour as combinations of keys can other keys. You can see this when playing Elite. If I try and pitch up and roll right, it thinks that symbol shift is being pushed and I slow down to zero speed. So the next version of the board should hopefully fix this, so stay tuned for updates. Of course, with the first version of the PCB, there are some mistakes, and I had a couple of big ones. The first error was that somehow, despite copying the design from my tiny TV board, I completely messed up the ESD protection chip, so I've had to remove this and put some jumper wires in. I may just remove this IC completely, because I'm not really sure it's needed. The second error was on the speaker driver. During some over-enthusiastic BOM optimization, I accidentally placed a P-channel MOSFET instead of an N-channel one. So that didn't work at all. This was easily fixed, but I didn't have the right size one. Fortunately, my bodge is barely noticeable. So I've got a few kinks to work out before this can go on sale. Make sure to register your interest if you'd like one. Over the next few weeks, I'll be working on the next prototype, and I'll keep you all posted as I think this is really cool. I'll also do a follow-up video soon with a lot more technical details, as I know some of you will be keen to understand how it works under the hood.